Good evening. We are one day after Parashat Tzav. We started last week with Sefer Vayikra, the third book from the five. And this is the second parasha, which also was called Shabbat HaGadol, the big Shabbat, which means the Shabbat before Pesach. We call it Shabbat HaGadol, the great Shabbat, the big Shabbat. This parasha continued to speak in the same subject of the last parasha, sacrifices. We all know that there is two kinds of sins that a person makes. Actually, three different kinds of sins. One part of the sins that he makes is non-intentional sins, which means he was not aware of the fact that this is not allowed. Or even if he was aware of the fact that it's not allowed, that moment he did it not intentionally. He meant to do something A and he ended up doing something B, which happened to be a sin. But it wasn't intentional. For instance, a person is on a boat, and because he's on a boat, it's a different atmosphere. He forgot it's Shabbat today. He thought it's Sunday or Friday, whatever. He thought it's Friday. And it started Shabbat, and then an hour later he realized it's Shabbat, but in the meantime he lights fires. Obviously, if he was aware of the fact that it's Shabbat, he would not dare to touch the fire. So that's called a mistake in a day. He was aware of the fact that he's lighting fire, but he made a mistake. He lit it in a wrong day. It could be also that the person did it thinking is allowed. For instance, the person that is Baal Tshuva, he made repentance, is starting to keep Shabbat. And a few months later, someone saw him taking one pit of lemon out of the salad. The vegetable salad is a mixed salad. And then he said, hey, what are you doing? You're not allowed to take the bad out of the good. Every mixture that you have in Shabbat, you can only take the good out of the bad and not the bad out of the good. And the good and the bad, it's your decision what's considered good and what's considered bad. Why? I give you an example. It could be a mixture of pistachios and almonds. And you don't like the almonds, you like the pistachios. You decided that you want to get rid of the almonds and you take them out. Your friend has the same mixture and in his mind is the opposite. For him, the almonds is the great and the pistachios he doesn't like. You will take the almonds out, you're making a sin. He will take the pistachios out, he makes a sin. If he would take the almonds out, because he likes them, that's not a problem. So you see, the same transaction, for you it's a sin that it's considered a very serious sin. It's exactly like lighting fire on Shabbat, there's no difference, because remember, there are 39 restrictions on Shabbat, and the Torah never told you anywhere, not even by a hint, or by a clue, or anything like that, that one is more severe than the other. All of them are equally serious. Which means, if a person lights fire, if he writes on Shabbat, if he sows on Shabbat, if he puts seeds in the ground, or he plows the ground, or he makes laundry, or any of those things, each one is equally serious like the others. When it comes to this melacha borer, which means taking the bed out, in some cases, it's equal to entire humanity. For instance, if everyone take the pills out of the bowl, it's mixture of food and pills, the pills is the bad. Everyone agree the pills is the bad. But when it's a mixture of food, one is good in your eyes and one is not, you will have to take the good out of the bad. Even though that sometimes you have a mixture that you like both of them. But at this particular time, you want to eat first A and then B. You want to start with the pistachios, and 5 minutes later, you're going to eat the almonds. You don't like to eat them together. Because you prefer right now to start with A, and then later you're going to eat B. Right now, when you're touching the bowl, B is garbage. Even though in 5 minutes you're going to eat it. What you prefer to do right now, this, what you prefer to eat, that's what the good. What you don't want right now, you're not allowed to take. Even if you later will know, you know that you're going to eat it and so forth. So if a person took it out, and there's so many people that I met that are not even aware of that sin, and you tell them, hey, it's not allowed, it's Chilul Shabbat, until now, every time he did it, his sin was considered a non-intentional sin. What's the difference when it comes to Shabbat, when a person makes Chilul Shabbat purposely or not purposely? The difference is huge. If it's intentionally, the punishment for that Chas v'Shalom is stoning, execution, plus karet for the soul. The soul gets cut out of the entire nation. In this life, in the life after life, end of story, unless if he's able to make repentance in his lifetime. And if it's not intentional, all he has to do is bring one lamb into Bet HaMikdash and repent for his sins. Which means in today's days, $300, $400, $500 plus the time it takes to go back and forth to Yerushalayim. In the old days it was a huge hassle to take a carriage, to go all the way in the mountains to Yerushalayim. There was no roads like today. Obviously there's no trains, no car, none of these things. It wasn't something pleasant, the road all the way to Yerushalayim. And that's why you see that even 3 times a year, when we had to go to Bet HaMikdash, we are just a few days before Pesach. Pesach is one of the regalim, the 3 regalim. We have Sukkot, Pesach and Shavuot. Even though that it was a holiday and everyone had a great show in Bet HaMikdash with the rabbis and this and that, it wasn't an easy thing to do. It wasn't an easy thing to do. Needless to say, if a person makes every Shabbat a sin, then right away he has to take a lamb. And again, it's just endless. Therefore, people would be much more careful than today. Today, when a person makes a sin, he says, okay, I'm going to pray tomorrow, I cry a little bit, I ask Hashem to forgive me, I'll put some donation, end of story. This is the way people look at that today. In the old days, people had to go and sacrifice and stand there in Bet HaMikdash, and it will be a matter of a few days. So now, this parasha, among all the other things that the parasha discussed, the parasha speaks about chataim b'shogeg, sins that were made not intentionally. It's called korban chatat. And this is a mitzvah from the Torah, and if a person made a sin, not intentional sin, and now he has an obligation from the Torah to bring korban chatat, if he does not bring the korban chatat, there are 2 problems here. One is the sin that he made will not be erased. Remember, we are talking in a time of Bet HaMikdash. Today, when we don't have Bet HaMikdash, the repentance for those things is the prayers. Because the Bible says, "Veneshalma parim sfatenu," we'll pay the cows with our lips. Which means praying, learning Torah, this is the repentance for those kinds of sins. So, when a person did not bring the chatat, the korban, the sacrifice, he had two problems now. One, he did not erase the sin that he made. Second, he canceled another obligation from the Torah. Because once a person made a violation on Shabbat, or in any other time when it wasn't intentional and needs to bring a sacrifice, automatically he receives now a new obligation, which he didn't have yesterday. Yesterday, right now, if we're standing here, we don't have an obligation to bring chatat. We're going to make a sin now, not intentional, we're going to have now a new obligation we didn't have 5 minutes ago. And we cannot ignore the new obligation. You understand? There are some mitzvot in the Torah that are routine, that every day or every hour or every week or once a week or only at night or only in the day. For instance, a man has a mitzvah every day to wear tzitzit if he has 4 corners in his clothes. This is day, every day, not at night. A man or woman has an obligation to think about God all the time. There's not 1 second in our life that we are dismissed from this obligation and except when we are inside the bathroom or dirty places. Then we cannot think about Torah and things like this. But you have to understand, a person in every open second in his life, whether he's in business, whether he's in yeshiva, whether he walks in the street, whether he takes the bus, whatever he does, we always have an obligation. It's called Shiviti Hashem Lenegdi Tamid. Hashem is always in front of me. So, some mitzvot is once a year. 7 days. Pesach, 7 days. Sukkot, 7 days. Once a year. You have a cycle, you finish with that. But some mitzvot, you'll never have the obligation to do it unless if you hit the opportunity. For instance, If you walk in the street and you see a nest with a bird with some eggs in it, now because you took that block, you entered that street or you made a shortcut through the forest, because of what you did, that leads you to a new obligation you didn't have. You don't have an obligation right now to make this mitzvah. If a person all his life never saw birds, all his life, when he dies, Hashem will not punish him for not making this mitzvah. Why? I never saw birds. No, I never saw birds in the nest. Therefore, I never had the obligation. But if I went through the forest and right in front of me I had the eggs, now I have to do the mitzvah because I came through here. Now I have a new obligation. The same thing if you walk in the street. If you didn't see any poor people, as you walk in the street, you have no obligation. You have to get from here to there. That's it. All of a sudden, a poor person came with his hand open. Feed me, I'm starving. Now you have an obligation to feed him, to help him out, to buy him food, or to give him money to buy food, or to help him out, or to bring him to your home, whatever the scenario may be. This obligation you did not have when you left home, and you knew you're going to be an hour on the road, you left home with no extra obligations. Now when you hit the poor person, you receive a new obligation. Understood? Okay. Therefore, when a person make a non-intentional sin, he receives a new obligation which was not mandatory. A person never make any sins in his life, not intentional, therefore all his life he never had to bring a lamb to Beit HaMikdash. He never had that obligation to bring a Korban Chatat. Now, the Chatat is not just for every non-intentional sin. Only non-intentional sin that the Torah says the punishment of karet next to it. Such as eating chametz in Pesach. We are a few days before Pesach. One of the most severe sins in the Torah, in the entire Torah, are eating non-kosher food for Pesach, which means has chametz in it. Wheat, barley, beer, wheat stretch, starch, all kinds of names that they put in the food, in the process, they process the food sometimes, even the rice. They put the rice, sometimes they bleach it with flour to make it white. If you have rice and you put it in a bowl without washing it first, very good, and then you put water on top and you cook it, you eat chametz in Pesach, 100%. Why? Because this rice, the way they process it, they take it because it's not so clean, they mix it with flour, the flour makes it look beautiful, white. And that's, I guess, better for business. Whether you knew or not, it's still a sin. The difference is that when a person made it not intentional, now his repentance will be to bring a lamb to Beit HaMikdash. If he does it purposely, knowing it's wheat in it, flour, and he still eats it, that's already called, consider karet, v'nichreta nefesh ha'im Yisrael. Every time a person made a not intentional sin that he has to bring, that if he did it purposely, it would be karet for his soul. In that case, the replacement for that will be korban chatat, which has to bring to Beit HaMikdash. Also, the way it's been done is when two witnesses saw you making the sin. And they came and they gave you atra'ah, they told you, you know what you're doing is not right, you're not allowed to do it, because of ABC, that's what the Torah says. Another example who has to bring this sacrifice is a person that swear for a lie in a Jewish court. He came to Jewish court and he swore that he doesn't owe that individual the money that he sues him for. But the problem is that the way he swore, it was a lie, but it wasn't a purpose lie, not purposely. He thought he gave him the money. It was a misunderstanding. He sent it to him with a guy, and the guy lied to him and told him, trust me, I gave him the money in his hand, and he trusted him. And now when he came to court, he swore that he gave back the money, and apparently, a week later, they found out that the way he swore was not true. And he said, yeah, well, what do you want from me? Look, this guy misled me. Okay, therefore, even though he's really, in a way, he's innocent, because he swore with the name of Hashem for something that is wasn't correct, he has to bring Korban Chatat. If a person does it purposely, that's one of this list that is correct. Chas v'shalom, when a person comes to court, he holds the Torah and he swore in the name of Hashem, knowing he's lying. This is the third commandment in the Ten Commandments. The Torah says, Lo tisa et shem Hashem lashav, ki inake lo inake. Hashem will not forgive a person that does such a sin. Swearing with the name of Hashem, and that's a very serious crime. Whether he swore on the past, whether he swore about the future, whether he swore about the present, it doesn't matter. Either way, if he swore not intentionally about something that is not correct, his repentance will be to bring Korban Chatat. Someone who worships idols not intentionally. If a person bows down to an idol not knowing it's a big sin from the Torah. For instance, he went to a reform shul. He was looking for a shul in town. He was an ignorant. He doesn't know anything about the laws. And someone told him, you're looking for a shul? Come, I'll take you to a shul. And he brought him into a reform shul. And just to let you know, one reform rabbi 2 days ago announced that it's about time the Jews will learn the New Testament. Can you believe? They are worse than the Hamas terrorists, these reforms. And they call themselves Jews. They destroyed every good piece of, every little good thing about Judaism, they make sure to destroy it, from A to Z. They marry men with men, they marry men with goyot, they eat not kosher, they work on holidays, they light fire on Shabbat. There's not one mitzvah from the Torah, according to this moment, that they keep in the right way. Not one mitzvah from the Torah. And when you ask him, he called himself the rabbi from Philadelphia. Philadelphia is full of this reform. You have to also know one thing. People ask this question. How come they have most of the money? When you go to their synagogue, each synagogue is $10 million, $20 million. A lot of money they have. Each one of the members in this reform shuls is the president of this company, the executive of that company, the vice president of this company, all the millionaires and billionaires and the doctors and the lawyers. And when you come to the Orthodox shuls, shoemaker, car service driver, moving company, unemployed,
barber.
Yeah, some here and there you see doctors and lawyers. I don't say, you know. But you see different life, different style. You have to know one thing. Learn this, put it very well inside your brain. Never ever forget this. The more money the institution has, it's more fishy. I repeat, if you see a wealthy organization, something is fishy over there, 100%. And this is the way it's working. The most wealthy institution in the entire world is the Christian Church. Nobody is wealthier than them. 100% lie, Christianity, from A to Z. Not one drop of truth inside this religion. All lies, all against the original Torah, calling themselves New Testament, Old Testament, 150,000 different texts in their books, in the New Testament, 150,000 different texts. And this is the number one wealthy organization in the entire world. Half of United States lands, hundreds of acres of lands in every state, in the entire country, they own. They don't know what to do with the money. They don't even sell. I'll give you an example. In Muncie, where we live, they have about 10, 20 acres church, not 10 people showing up on Sunday over there, because there's no Christians in Muncie anymore. They have 10 acres of land. There's a church over there, hardly anyone showing up there. Plus they own lots, 10, 20, 30 acres. When they bought it, it was $1,000 an acre when they bought it. Today, it's $400,000 an acre. Understand the difference between $1,000 to $400,000? They don't use it, and they just don't sell it, because they have nothing to do with that. Just keep it. It will go down, it will go down. It will go up, no problem. Just keep it forever. Why? They have nothing to do with the money. They're just drowning in the money. Why? Because this is the filthiest, impure organization that Hashem hates the most. After them, who is next? Hindus, Muslims, mosques. Look at the mosques. Saudi Arabia, in all kinds of places, the mosques are very, very wealthy. Go inside the mosque in Manhattan, you have $20 million mosque in 96th Street. Every mosque in the Middle East, Persian rugs, beautiful chandeliers, everything. Drowning in money. The Hindus, all the temples in India, all these places. In India in general, everyone is poor, starving to bread. But you go into the Hindu temples and all the other temples in the places, in Thailand, in China, in all these places, Buddhist and Hindus, is the wealthiest place. It's all pure gold, unbelievable. When you come finally to Judaism, who has the most money in our religion? Reform. Yom Kippur, people come with a car, with a pita in their hand. And the priest and the rabbi will dance with the piano on the stage. The lady rabbi, with the miniskirt, and a yarmulke on her head. Well, you should be embarrassed on one thing. She puts a yarmulke and you don't. You're embarrassed to put the yarmulke. But she's not embarrassed. I saw one of them walking on the street with a yarmulke. Yeah. So they loaded. They bring the Puerto Rican goy and Sukkot in Yom Tov to build the sukkah with the drill. In Yom Tov. And that's not a joke. Inside the day, the Shabbat, the Yom Tov, they bring the goyim, they build up the sukkah for them with the drills. This is them. And they sit in the sukkah, Jews, non-Jews, dogs on the floor. Ramash, beautiful. Pork on the table, cheese, cheeseburgers. Unbelievable. And you think I'm being sarcastic, but believe me, I did not exaggerate by 1% what I said. Unfortunately, I wish I would. But that's the case. Then the conservative, right after them, very wealthy. They have a lot of money, they don't know what to do with that. Most of the money they give Zionism. What? They don't know what to do with that, so they donate Israeli army, the lands in Israel, this museum, that museum. That's where the money goes there. Finally, we come to the Orthodox world. The Orthodox world, that's what you see Orthodox Jews, black yarmulke, black hats. You see them in some places in the world. So Baruch Hashem, some of them has more money than others. The shoes that are very fancy and big, you cannot hear the reading of the Torah in Shabbat from the talking. Ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, business, that. Ha, you bought that, you sold the building. Wow, how are you doing? How your grandma is doing? Chazak u'baruch. You cannot hear. Everyone comes to make a show. 20,000, 30,000. Finally, when it comes to the place where God is really loved, people who learn, people who really pray with the bottom of their heart, leak from the floor, no rugs, the floor is broken. The building is from the times of the Romans. It's crooked already. Come to the yeshivot, you see, in Israel, here. The places when it's pure Torah, there's just barely enough money to pay even for tea, cup of tea. I can tell you that in our yeshiva, the air condition has a lock. Cannot afford to pay the electric bill. They have a lock. Only in days that is mamash gehenom, hell, then the rabbi agrees to open the box and to put the air condition on 75, that you can breathe, that you can see the letters in the Gemara. Why? It's better that the people learn than fall on the floor. Yes. In Israel, it's even worse. You come to shul, 1,500 people inside the shul. One pray after the other. Air condition for the building, no money to pay for it. So what happened? They have an air condition with a hole. You put 5 shekel in, it lights for 10 minutes, the air condition. Everyone is dying until the first volunteer will put a coin. Then Baruch Hashem will be able to pray without sweating. That's the situation, yes. But over there, that's the holiness. That's how it works. The more money you have, it shows that God pay you in this life, which is a curse. Everything that people think, maybe you start getting used to the other way around. It should be the other way around. The more money God gives this institution, it's not a good sign. And that's what you should always remember. Because the Torah, the Torah says, be very careful with the poor people, because the Torah will come from their descendants. And that's a fact. Where do you see kids that love more to learn Torah? In Great Neck or in Bnei Brak? Let's be honest. How many Talmidei Chachamim came from Great Neck since the Jewish community started that? Not even one. I promise you, not one. How many Talmidei Chachamim comes from Great Neck every year from Bnei Brak? Thousands. Why? They leave 9 kids in one little room with a leak. No heat in a winter. And they eat rye bread with cheese and cucumber, and if they're lucky, once a week they get tomato and an egg. And that's reality. Over there, all the Gdolei Israel, almost with no exception, I would say at least 90%, those great ones that became huge, holy rabbis, came from nothing, came from poverty, came from modest life. Once you start getting involved with fancy things, you know you're out of the way. It's a rule. There's nothing you can do about it. Nobody can contradict that. Nobody. And of course, there's always a rule and there's an exception to the rule. There's a rule and exception to the rule. This is life. From time to time, you heard about a millionaire rabbi that also became holy. But the Gemara says, one of the rabbis, I think it was Rabbi Yoshua, was very, very ugly. Very ugly. Like if you look at his face, you get scared. That's what the Gemara says. And he walked in the street, and the daughter of the king, the princess, saw him on the street and said, hey, Rabbi, such wisdom and such dirty tool, which means such a brain and such an ugly body, ugly face, such an ugly head. So he told her, can I ask you a question? She said, yeah, what's the question? He said, tell me, your father, the king, where does he put the wine? She says, in ceramic barrels, like everybody else. That's where you put the wine, no? He said, isn't it a shame? The wine of the king is in barrels like all the poor people in the market. You're the king. The minimum you should do is put it in silver and gold coins. You can afford it. So you know what? You're right. We should be a little bit above the average people. I'll let my father know. She went to her father. She said, Dad, why we behave like all the poor people in the street? We are the controllers. Why don't we put the wine in beautiful, nice barrels of silver and gold? That's the way a king should behave. He said, no, thank you for giving me the advice. They took all the expensive old wine of many, many years they keep. They move it into silver and gold barrels. 3 days later, it became vinegar. 99 cents a barrel. So, her father comes to her, you fool! What advice you gave me? All the wine is spoiled. She said, it wasn't my advice, it was the head rabbi of the Jews. That smart man, remember him? He gave me the advice. They called him up right away. And they told him, hey, what did you do? Look, you caused us to lose fortune. And he said, listen, she started with me. What do you want from me? She started with me, and I answered the same. She said, well, what do you mean? She told me, how come such knowledge and Torah is in such ugly face, inside of such an ugly body? And I told her, how come the wine, it's in such ugly barrels? The same thing. So the father said, but she's right. Couldn't God make you a little bit more handsome? He said, if I would be a little bit more handsome, I wouldn't be what I am today. You understand? I would be busy with Yetzer Hara. I would be more busy with things, with other things. The Gemara says, Marbe Nechasim, Marbe Neagot. The more a person has positions, the more he gains another store, another building, another property, another one, another jewelry, another. There's always something that occupied his mind. What's happening in the business? Who steals from you? Who's on the way to hurt you? Did you pay taxes? Maybe you're going to get audit. Maybe your partner is doing. Well, you're going to find a buyer. What happens if the merchandise gets stale? always his mind is with these things. When a person only has what to eat, his mind is pure, just to think what Hashem wants him to think. So, the parasha also describes, all the orders of the korbanot, the shlamim, all the korbanot. I don't want to get into it. The yemei miluim and all that. Next week we're gonna continue in the same thing, which called parashat shmini, more or less in the same. Next week it's the Pesach. You know, obviously it's the parasha of Pesach. But I want to say a few words about Pesach and then continue with something else. As I told you 1 or 2 weeks ago, I recommended that everyone will eat as much as they can, all the chametz in the house, to leave almost nothing. When we enter Pesach on Wednesday already morning, we cannot keep chametz in the house. After 4 hours from the sunrise, 4 hours from the sunrise, we're talking around 10 o'clock, 10:30, something like that. We're not going to be able to keep any chametz in the house anymore. Not to eat, not to keep. If we kept, we have to then later destroy it. For 1 extra hour, we'll be able to still sell it to a goy or give it as a gift. After that, we're not going to be able even to give it out or to get the money back. Once we kept it after 6 hours from the day, which is around 1 o'clock, from this moment on, this chametz can never cause you any kind of pleasure or benefits for eternity. Which means, if you have now whiskey, beer, expensive chametz that you have in the house, which you forgot about, and you're going to find it on Wednesday at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, from this moment on, you cannot do anything with this chametz but to destroy it. Unless if you sold it to a goy. If you know you made an arrangement, you put it in the closet, you went to the rabbi and you made an agreement to sell it to the goy. Last week I say why this agreement with the goy is not so recommended. Because the chance that it's legit is not so great, because the goyim are not so interested to buy dough and to buy crumbs or to buy some chametz in a plate. That's not exactly in their mind. So this whole agreement is a little bit shaky. It was more designed for stores that have tons of chametz and they cannot get rid of it before Pesach. And then individuals took advantage on that agreement. My suggestion to you is, still enough, we have Monday, we have Tuesday, and we have an hour or two in the morning of Wednesday and finish. If you didn't finish your chametz, you still have spaghetti, you still have all kinds of things, try to eat it today and tomorrow. You couldn't eat it, give it to the goyim, to the cleaning lady, to the neighbors, to the doorman, whatever. If you didn't find what to do with that, just go and burn it on Wednesday morning. On Wednesday morning, you collect the rest of the chametz that you have in a table where you ate breakfast, whatever. You collect everything, you vacuum the rest, you take the shoev avak, the vacuum cleaner bags, don't forget to keep it in the house. You take it out with the rest of the pieces of the chametz from the last night's checking that you checked, and you put it inside one bag and you go and you burn it. I'm sure they're going to have some places to burn the chametz. If they don't have a place here in Queens to burn the chametz, they do. In case you couldn't get there, you break it to small crumbs in the bathroom and flush. Make sure you flush very well and finish. Right after you do that, you have to read from the Haggadah in the beginning, in the first or second page of the Haggadah, you'll find the text to cancel the chametz, which means you're announcing that in case you have any chametz left, whether in your car, whether in your house, in your other house, in your office, in your store, that means in your possession, from this moment on, you're canceling it, you're not interested in it, it will be like sand on the ground. Therefore, even if you forgot wafers here or cookies there, and you didn't know any attic, you didn't check, you forgot about it in the last minute, it automatically becomes sand. And therefore, if you find it in the middle of Pesach or after Pesach, later on you get rid of it. You cannot eat it, obviously, as I told you. Every chametz that stayed by you, you cancel, you have to get rid of it. If you don't have any whiskey bottles, there's no reason why you should make an agreement with a goy to sell him anything. Because the only expensive chametz that I can think of is whiskey bottles. The rest is not expensive. Spaghetti is 99 cents a pack. Cookies, $2 or $3 a pack. Big deal. You eat it. You have enough time to eat it. Still two more days, it's a lot. And that's just this. Don't forget to take a haircut. By tomorrow, by Tuesday night, you should be, all of you should take very short haircut because we have 33 days. Yeah, 33 days, and we cannot take haircuts or shave. So those who likes to shave daily or every other day, make sure you shave, that you cannot shave for 33 days. Those who grow beard, then they have no problems. It's be a little bit longer. But haircut, be careful. To take advantage, by Tuesday night, you want to get it over with. Take short haircut. Why? Because you don't want your hair to grow like this and it's not comfortable. Yes?
Hey, just a quick question, Rabbi. Let's say your work, you work in a certain area where you can't, you know, have a beard. It affects your job. Are you allowed to?
There are some rabbis that allowed for Rosh Chodesh, for instance, which is Pesach. We cannot shave from the 15 days of Pesach, right? So Rosh Chodesh, or the next Rosh Chodesh Iyar, will be 2 weeks later. So a person grow beard for 2 weeks is not that long. And then he shave lichvod Rosh Chodesh. That's one lenient opinion in the halacha. Some say lichvod Shabbat. I cannot allow something that the books did not allow. I'm just telling you, there are some books that allow lichvod Rosh Chodesh to shave. But remember, right after Pesach, we are going into 49 days of Omer. The Omer, 49 days. Some people do not shave for 49 days. But I want to just remind you a few things that in case you're not going to remember. From the moment we have Leila Seder is the 15 days of Nisan. 15 days, the night, it's starting the day, right? So that means Wednesday night, it's already Thursday. Thursday in a Jewish calendar, it's the 15 days of Nisan. From that moment until Shavuot, we have 49 days. Those 49 days is the days of the Omer. The students of Rabbi Akiva were dying, 24,000 students of Rabbi Akiva were dying in a terrible disease in a period of 49 days, until Shavuot. It's also preparation for accepting the Torah. From Pesach, which was the exodus of Egypt, until we receive the Torah, we have 49 days. In those days, every night, once we see stars, we have a mitzvah of counting the Omer, which means if you come to shul every night to pray Arvit, you're going to see everyone does it together. Right after Arvit, the Chazan make a bracha, Baruch Ata Hashem Elokeinu Melech HaOlam Asher Kiddushanu Mitzvotav Mitzvanu Al Sfirat HaOmer, which means, bless you God, that order us to count the Omers, the day of the Omer. What was the Omer? Right after Pesach, the next day, they used to bring the wheat, sacrifice a bunch of wheat, and the Kohen used to bring it up like this, tnufa, and that would allow all the wheat that was cut before to be eaten after Pesach, which means the Torah said to eat old, which means old in Israel, it's not a problem because they cut everything before Pesach, because the season, they cut it before. But the Korban allows all the wheat in the entire country to be eaten until the following Rosh Hashanah, after Rosh Hashanah. And that's what it's called Korban HaOmer. So from then the Torah say you have to count days and weeks. This is a mitzvah, like the same thing putting tefillin. It's a mitzvah from the Torah. So the Torah say every night, once you see stars, even if a person did not go to shul, he can do it at home. Every night, just have to make a sign somewhere that he won't forget, or next to his bed, or on his watch, or in a place that you know you don't forget. And every day you say, Baruch Ata Hashem, Elokeinu Melech HaOlam, Asher Kiddushanu Mitzvotav Etzivanu, Ad Sfirat HaOmer, today, Ayom, Yom Echad LaOmer. You say, today, it's one day to the Omer. Finish. Next day, the same bracha. Today, it's Yom Sheni LaOmer, second day to the Omer. 3, 4, 5, every day you count one. If you forgot to count at night, the next day when you wake up, you can still count. But in the day, you don't make a bracha. You count without a bracha. And then at night, you can continue with bracha. Which means, if tonight you forgot, tomorrow, if tonight you forgot to make the bracha, tomorrow you can still make a bracha. Tomorrow night, you can still make a bracha. Why? Because tomorrow, you're going to count the Omer. Now pay attention. After 7 days, once we come to the 7 days, we say, Ayom, today it's 7 days to the Omer, which is 1 week. Then when we get to the 8 days, we say today it's 8 days to the Omer, which is 1 week and 1 day. Understand? You have it in a Sidur. If you need instruction, just open the Sidur, the counting of the Omer, and we'll give you all the instructions. This was another mitzvah. So remember, haircut, by Tuesday night you want to get it over with. Shaving and haircut. Also, right after we are in the exile, we have 2 days of holiday. Two. Not like in Israel, they have only 1 day. In Israel it starts Wednesday night, it's finished Thursday night. Finished. 24 hours. Which means Thursday night it's Chol HaMoed. People turn music on, they drive the car Thursday night. A regular night. 1 day, 24 hours. And the same thing in the end. And the end of the holiday, 1 day. Here it's 2 and 2. Plus we have Shabbat in the middle. Therefore, since we have 8 days of holiday, 5 of them will become like Shabbat. You cannot drive, you cannot smoke, you cannot write, no radio, nothing. Okay? Now, this is I'm repeating again. We have Wednesday night is the first Leila Seder. Thursday night, it's a second Seder, which is a repeat of the first one, 100% same. 2 days holiday, which is like Shabbat. And in this case, it's attached to Shabbat. Therefore, it's very difficult this year. It's 3 days in a row Shabbat. 3 days in a row. Which with one exception, two exceptions. That Thursday during the day and Friday during the day, it's Yom Tov. Which means you can carry things from the house to the shul or to the street. Carry with you things in a pocket or with a hand, which you cannot do in Shabbat. And second is, you can take one fire from another existing fire. Which means, if you want to light the oven, you buy a 72-hour candle or 1 week candle, and you can take from an existing fire and light another fire. This is that's the rule that applies to every Yom Tov, every holiday. Now, on Shabbat, you cannot touch fire, take from an existing fire. Shabbat, you don't play with fire. Those are the two exceptions. The prayers are a little bit different. It's more or less the same style, but a little bit different. Because in Pesach, you say, "V'chag ha-matzot hazeh, zman cherutenu." This is the holiday of the freedom, so you have to say it in a prayer. We also pray Musaf in the morning, because in the time of Bet HaMikdash, we used to have Korban Musaf. So now we have 3 days in a row, Rak Shabbat. Then Sunday, it's Chol HaMoed. Sunday, Monday, it's Chol HaMoed. What does it mean, Chol HaMoed? Half Shabbat, half weekday. Which means, you can drive a car, you can light fire, but you cannot write. Chol HaMoed. There are certain things you're not allowed to do in Chol HaMoed. If you want to learn all the laws of Chol HaMoed, you have a Kitzur Shulchan Aruch here, or Shulchan Aruch, in English, or in Russian, or in Hebrew, whatever you read, and you go at least once in your life to go over all the rules that apply to Chol HaMoed. One thing you should know, a Jew that works in the days between the first holiday to the end of the holiday, which means the days in between are called Chol HaMoed, has no blessing with his income ever. No matter how much you're going to make, you're not going to see any sign of blessing with this money. Therefore, it's stupid to go to work. If you can afford to take 8 days off, you will only have it twice a year. Sukkot, 8 days off, and Pesach says 8 days off, which means 16 days a year. If it's impossible for you, if you get fired from work, then you go. There's no. Because the Torah said, the Shulchan Aruch allows to make business with one condition. If a poor person has nothing to eat, if he doesn't eat, if he doesn't make money today, he will starve, then he's allowed. And there's another exception. If there is a deal that will never ever return, you're allowed to go do the deal and come back home. For instance, if you are a wholesaler, and he has a Chinese buyer, give you a call on a Monday morning, your business is closed. He called you to your cell, "I'm in town, I want to see merchandise because I need to buy thousands of yards of material." And you said, "And I'm going tomorrow back to Japan." If you're not going to open up the store, the deal is finished. It's going to go to one of your competitors. Then, in this case, you're allowed, you go, you open up the store. If you sell, you sell. You didn't sell, you didn't sell. You finish with this meeting and you close it back. Or if you have an opportunity, someone told you, only today you can buy this car for half a price. It's a sale. And you're a car dealer. You know, today, the company, if you go to the place in Pennsylvania, they'll give you the car for half a day. It's called Davar HaAved. Something that is about, it has a specific time, which fails on Chol HaMoed, you're allowed to do it. But this is for ignorance. This is for people who have no trust in God. Someone who trusts God, that He supplies you with your money from Rosh Hashanah to Rosh Hashanah, and He doesn't need specific day to give you the money, because it was pre-decided. Rosh Hashanah, Hashem already decided how much money you're going to make. Therefore, why do you eat your heart? You close the business, you close on Shabbat, there's many customers wants to come, what do you care? The money doesn't come from the customer. This is all an illusion. This is all a cover-up. We spoke about it in the past. We're going to give some example about it soon. But the money comes because God wants to give you X amount of money. That's His decision. He's already going to find a way how to send you the money. Whether you open a store, whether you're not opening a store, whether you have one store, whether you have five stores, you will receive what God wants to give you. That does not make more impression on God that you open a chain of locations now. He wants to send you $100,000 net this year, whether you have one store, whether you have hundreds of stores, and the stores will boom and you make fortunes. In the end of the year, you will net what God wants you to net. That's why a lot of people kill themselves, running around, trying here, trying there, and in the end, it's like a person that have one barrel of wine, and he have one faucet. And when you open up the faucet, there's X amount of wine falling. Now he say, you know what, I'm going to get more wine. Let me install another faucet. So he installed another faucet, he opened two now. Double amount of wine coming out. But one thing this person does not realize. What does he not realize? That the amount of wine inside the barrel is the same amount. Whatever God wants to give you, that's what He's going to give you. That's why, if God told you, stay home in Chol HaMoed, enjoy with your wife, enjoy with your family, enjoy with your parents, enjoy with your friends, learn, take some time off, take a trip on Chol HaMoed. The places are full with religious people, if you realize. The Bronx Zoo, the Safari, the Six Flags, they take their kids. Finally, there's some time to have to be with the family. Or to do all kinds of things that you never have the time to. And the prayers is longer every day in the morning. Therefore, when a person does it, there's no way in a history that a Jew will ever lose a penny because he listened to God more than the other people on the street. Did it ever occur to you that you going to listen to the Creator of the world, which told you, take 8 days off and enjoy with your family because it's my holiday and I gave it to you? Does it occur to you that you, because of that, going to lose money? Is it possible to even think such a thing? That I'm listening to him, I'm going to lose. That wicked person in the store that opens on Shabbat, opens every day, eat in Kippur, eat Chametz, he's going to make money because he's wicked, and we're going to be righteous and we lose money? Look how low sometimes we can come. I'm going to give you some examples about faith. Some examples. First of all, Rav Mibrisk, there was a big rabbi from Brisk, and he used to teach his children Emunah. And this is what he wrote. Rav Chaim Mivolozhin wrote a very deep Kabbalah book. He was a student of the Vilna Gaon more than 200 years ago, and this is what he wrote. Every time a person has crisis in his life, lack of faith, problems in his business, problems in his personal life, you should always remember one thing, to say those words. Pay attention. God is the only God. There is no other power in the entire creation but the control of God. To say it. God, you are the only one and everything is in your hand. Nothing, nothing, nothing but your hand can affect me for good or bad unless if this is what you want. The rest is illusion. The goy attack me, the IRS after me, the FBI wants to get me. This is all nonsense. This, the relationship between you and your God. If it's good, you have nothing to be afraid of. If you know you have a lot of guilt in you, the way you behave, the way you live, the way you steal, the way you lie, the way you curse, the way you wake up in the morning, the way you don't pray, the way you never learn Torah, the way you don't put tefillin. By the way, in Chol HaMoed, 8 days now you don't put tefillin. From Thursday morning until the following Friday, which means 8 days, from Thursday to Thursday, include Thursday, you don't put tefillin. The following time you put tefillin is Friday morning. 8 days later, after Leila Seder. We don't put tefillin. I'll give you an example. One rich person came to Rav Chaim Ibrisk and he asked him, I lost all my money, Rabbi. Why God took away all my money? So he told him, I'll give you an example. One father gave his son a knife. And when he saw that his son cutting his fingers with a knife, he ran and took away the knife from him. Do you understand the message? He asked him, what was the message? Who understand? The rich person came to him and said, Rabbi, I had a lot of money and God took away everything. Why? So he told him, a father gave a knife to his son. He saw the son cut his fingers and he took away the knife from him. You know what comes out of this story? That sometimes when a person has too much, that's his cancer. That's his poison. That's going to bury him. In most cases, you don't have to believe me, look at the statistic of all the Lotto winners. They made one time an article, except two. All of them suffer. Divorce, problem, gambling, problems with people, problems there, problems there. Each one of them admitted that the money only did bad for them. Except two that knew what to do with the money. Most people, once they didn't have money, they were connected to God. Help me, I need to get a job. Nobody will help me. God, please help me out. We need your prayer. You're connected. You have millions in your account. You have no excitement. You don't have anyone to talk to. What do you need God for? You okay? Look at me, I'm fat, I'm healthy, I'm wealthy, I have enough for the entire 20, 30 years. What do I need him for? That's the mentality of a human being. Only very few people are able to take the wealth and take it to their advantage. Most people, the wealth makes them go further from God. And the Torah warned about it. The Torah says, be careful that you won't gain weight and you become established and your neck will become great. Yeah, I'm making it in a modern language, but this is what the Torah says. Shamer lecha, and then what's going to be? And you're going to say, my strength and my talent made me all this wealth. And you're going to forget about your God. You should remember that God is the only one that gave you everything you had. You should stick to His mitzvot, follow it, and so forth and so on. And this is a sentence in the Torah. Not the rabbis made it up. It's in the text of the Torah. It comes in a few different versions, in a few different places in the Torah. But if God gave you a book and inside it says, everything you have, I'm giving you. Why do you need to challenge Him? Why did you need to have a doubt in it? Where does this chutzpah come from? That's what we have to ask ourselves. What came to our mind after 3,200 years that every Jew was a great believer? Check history. All of a sudden that we have, the more we have, the more doubts we receive. The more we are not sleeping well at night. The more we worry about the future. I once spoke to a guy that made tens of millions in a deal. And from the moment he made all this money, he was worried about his future more than before. It's interesting. And I say, I don't understand, why are you so worried about how to invest the money? You can just put the money, get 5, 6, 7% interest, and you'll be wealthy for the rest of your life without any problems. Don't touch it. Don't invest, don't take risks, just sleep well, you make a few hundred thousand dollars a year and you never touch the actual money. Conservative investment by the bank with guarantee of the government, everything is fine. What is so worried? He never had rest from the moment he made the money. Why? Because every day that he didn't invest it right and he didn't make the potential that he could have made was eating his heart. So in this case, it's good that your life become like this. It depends how much greed a person has. Each one has more or less greed than his friends, depends how he left the life in his previous life. The way you died, that's the way you designed now to be. You were stingy when you died, you were stingy when you born. You don't want to give one pretzel to the friends in the neighborhood when you're 2 years old. You look at the kids. One will give you the entire bag, the other one doesn't want to give you one. If you take one pretzel from him, he has thousands in a bag, hundreds. You took one, he cried for 2 hours. How is it possible? Is it logical? It's a disease. How a 2 years old kid has such a disease? From his previous life. It's the same soul that was in a different body and now he was reincarnated in a new body, and soon you wait and see, when he'll be 17, it'll be the same thing. And that's his correction in life, that's his test. Same way you fell in your previous life, you fell again. So if you know you have a problem now, you know this is the way you were. And that's what you have to focus on correcting. So he told him, if they cut their fingers, why should he give them the knife? That's why the father took the knife from the kid. When God sees that a person does bad things with his money, if he likes him, he takes the money away from him. Why? That later he will punish him less. If he doesn't like him, he let him stay with the money, he's suffering this life, plus he has to get the punishment when he comes to his trial for all the things he did bad with his money, and second punishment for all the things he could have done with his money and he didn't take the opportunity to do. You understand? And in the end, every one of these fools will say, God, why did you do such a bad thing to me? Why you gave me all this money? You wait and see. All these people that ran after money and gained the money and did nothing spiritual with that, didn't build yeshivot, didn't sponsor yeshivot, didn't donate Torah, didn't help the poor, didn't help the widows, did not help all kinds of good causes, did not donate to duplicate this, to give some Jews, to teach them a little bit about Judaism, did not donate books to synagogue, did not do all kinds of things that money can buy. They have serious responsibility to the problems of the Jewish nation. When God gives a person so much, you have to understand, he gave him an opportunity, he gave him responsibility, he gave him a mission, and this person failed on his mission. He did not do what he received the money for. God didn't give him the money to buy another building in Spain. Why does he need him to have a building in Spain? Without it, he cannot send him Parnassah here in New York. You know, one Jew came he went out of town, and he came to a town and he saw all the goyim worship idols. He got very angry at them. He started to scream, give them the Sichat Musar. Hey, what are you doing? Why you bow down to the sun? Why you bow down to the moon? Don't you see this is not God? Start to scream. He got fanatic. You know, that was beautiful. Until one goy answered him back. You know what the goy told him? Who is your God? He said, my God is the God of heaven and earth, the God of Abraham. And he said, what is the difference between your God to our God? We look the same, we eat the same, whatever you have, we have. So he told him, no, whatever you had, you get from my God, not from your God. All these things you see, God, my God made it. So he told him, so you are a great believer in your God? In this case, tell me please, the goy asked him, what do you do in this town? He said, I came to sell my merchandise, to make business here. I'm on a business trip, he told him. He said, if your God is so great, he cannot give you money in your hometown? You had to come all the way here to receive money? That's what the goy told him. This is a message for us. I'm going to go to Miami, Rabbi. I'll make more money there. I have an opportunity in L.A. Who bring you these opportunities? The Satan. Satan see you doing very well here. You're religious, you have a shul, you have yeshiva, you're coming, you're learning, you're becoming better. The Satan say, listen, this guy full of excitement. He comes every day to shul, he learns, he becomes better and better. How do I get him to collapse? One way. Let's offer him a great job in Florida. He comes to Florida, not the same shul, not the same rabbi. What's going on the street, the weather. In 1 week, he already forget about God and the Torah, and in 2, 3, 4 weeks later, he forgot about the tefillin already. It's impossible. Impossible to be tzaddik in certain places. Cannot be tzaddik in Las Vegas. You cannot be tzaddik in South Carolina. You cannot live on a beach in Miami and think that you can be tzaddik. Not that New York is much better. It's a little bit less worse. It's not as bad as there, because at least you have some places here that you can hide. You know, when you feel that your spiritual level is on the way down, you run to the yeshiva, Main Street, this, 108 Street. You have places where to come. There's lecture here, lecture there. You can knock on somebody's door. You come to the rabbi. Rabbi, I'm in a terrible situation. Help me out. Where are you going to go to Vegas? To who? To the one with shorts and sandals? I doubt that even those places we have one kosher minyan. One. Like San Diego, South Carolina, places like this. There are some places like Cleveland, Chicago, you have Jewish communities. No. But there are places, there's no permission to a Jew to step there even one day in his life. There's nowhere in the Torah that the Torah allow a person to make money on the expense on going down on the Torah and the mitzvot and his spiritual level. If you find one book that allow it, please bring it to me. I never saw one. I never saw one time. As an exception that you allow to go to a place that you know over there that your spiritual level will go down, but you know you're going to make a lot of money over there. I never saw. So in this case, tell me please, how come so many religious people, some of them had beards and beautiful sombrero? Tell me please, how do they go to these places? How can they be 1 week in a show in Vegas? I'm just asking myself. Maybe I'm wrong, I don't know. How can you be in a beach over there selling ice cream in Myrtle Beach? Like some people that claim they're religious, they do. This is a question, no? It's a very serious question. I didn't find anyone to give me an answer yet. And this question is also about 47th Street. Who say you're allowed to walk on 47th Street on the street? I don't know. The only example the Torah gave, maybe there's more, but I know, is when Lot went to Sodom, he was righteous. What happened to him? He became wicked. From this moment on that he arrived to Sodom, Hashem put an X on him. For eternity! And you know, believe me, none of these people with the beard and sombreros that goes to 47th Street near the level of Lot before he went to Sodom. None of them is near him. If he wasn't allowed to go there with his level, you have permission to go there. Why? Because you're going to make 500,000 a year. It's better to make 50 and stay in a place without making the sins that you may expose to over there. Nobody can claim that if he goes to a non-kosher place, it will not affect him. If someone claims that, he's a big liar. Don't believe him. The Gemara says, Rabbi Yossi was walking on the street, and a president of a very wealthy community came to him and said, Rabbi, we're dying. We don't have a rabbi to teach us Torah. Please, come to our community. We'll give you everything you want. You'll be the rabbi. We'll give you a salary, anything you want. Teach us Torah. What did he ask him? What did he ask him? To come teach them Torah. Yes, what an opportunity. The Torah said that Kiruv, bringing Jews into the Torah, it's the number one mitzvah in history. No mitzvah is greater than this. That's why Abraham considered so great. It was the first machzir b'tshuva, Abraham Avinu, bringing people back to Hashem. Plus, throughout history, if you read in the Zohar says if you live 70 years, poverty, problems, agony, pain, sicknesses, government, jail, pogroms, but you made one Jew religious, one! It was worth, your life was worth it, just for one. Nevertheless, 50, 500, 5,000. And even if you know, if you make 500 people religious in your life, which is possible to every one of you, it just depends how much you want. Just depend how much you are. First, you have to work on yourself. Once you reach a certain level, you can start helping others. Believe me, it's in your hand. If you have a little talent, you're able to talk. If you're unable to talk, fine. So you didn't get this gift. You may have money. You may sponsor. You don't have money. You may have a car. You can drive. You can duplicate tests. The disc. You can give it out. Every Jew you see, hey, here's a disc. Here is a book. Why don't you come to the lecture? You don't have a car. You have a telephone. Today it's very cheap telephones. You pay $30-$40, you have unlimited phone calls. You sit every day an hour and call Jews to come to the lecture. You call over the week to 100 people, 20 showed up from 100, one from tomorrow will start putting tefillin, one day become religious, one, him, his children, his grandchildren, grandchildren. If one of them would be the biggest rabbi in the world, it all goes to your account for a few phone calls. Everyone can do, no excuses. And that's an obligation to every Jew. Hochach tochiach et amitecha v'lo tisa alav chet. Plus, we have an obligation not to do bad things in public in front of people because we make them weak. I'll give you an example. Even if you're in yeshiva and you live in a dormitory with others, if you don't behave right, you have a problem between you and God. That's problem number one, which is a serious problem. Second problem is, when you come to God, God will tell you, you are machti arabim. You influence the public to make sins against me. You say, God, it has to be a mistake. I would never dare to do such a thing. The opposite. All my efforts I put to convince people to do mitzvot. You tell me I'm machti arabim? God say, yes, you want to see? Come see. Look the time you show up to the prayer in the morning. It starts at 7:30, you show up 20 to 8, 10 to 8. Somebody else see, hey, look at this guy, he always come 20 minutes behind me, and he always make it. Why should I come so early? One guy learned from your behaving. Or he saw, or your roommate in a room, in a dormitory, see, you don't wake up. You don't wake up, that's the Yetzer Hara. Why should I wake up? Because of you, somebody else doesn't wake up. And then somebody else doesn't wake up. And then half of the yeshiva doesn't want to wake up to pray. Why? Because one affects the other. Even not intentionally. Oh, Lashon Hara. You come to a place, you start speaking about someone. You're speaking about someone, you're affecting the other guy, and the other guy, and the other guy. Hundreds of people are speaking in a month because of you. You didn't plan it that way, but that was you. Because you never think before you do something. So, Rabbi Yossi answered him, you give me all the wealth in the world. I cannot live only in the place of Torah and holiness. No matter what you give me, you can't convince me. Now my question to you is, the Torah says there's a huge mitzvah to make Jews religious. Better than that, the Torah said that two people who does that, one in his hometown and one go to another town. The one who goes to another town, his reward is much, much greater than the one who does it locally. Much greater. And here they come to Rav Yossi, one of the greatest rabbis in the history. The Gemara, it was mechayem et him. He was able to revive the dead from his grave. That's how great he was. Take all the rabbis in the world together, they don't reach his level today. Rabbi Yossi, and what is the answer him? And it's in the Torah, it's in the Gemara. You give me all the wealth, everything. You know what he could have done with his wealth? There were very rich people in this town. They didn't have a rabbi. He said, we'll give you anything you want. That was the offer. Whatever, which means today millions will give you. Just come teach us Torah. We're not telling you to come dance in a bar with us. Come teach us Torah. Absolutely not. I don't live there one day. I don't go to Miami for one day to teach Torah or to live there. That's what he told them. Nevertheless, to San Francisco and all these places. And believe me, this was a Jewish community that told him to come. They didn't tell him to come to a place of women. This was a Jewish community without a rabbi. And he said, I'm not going there. There is no Torah in this place. I have no guarantee that I will be the same. I have guarantee that I will be the same if I come there. What about my children? Where they're going to learn, which yeshiva they're going to go to. That's what happened. Rabbi Yossi didn't know that to teach Torah it's the biggest mitzvah. Sure he knew. He didn't know that he can take all the millions they offer him and make other people also religious and invent and open shuls and yeshivot. He didn't know. Sure he knew. No, I have no permission to go 1% down on my level to help my other friends to become more religious. The Gemara says in Masechet Shabbat, one Jew put a cake inside the oven. Another 2 minutes, he will be executed. Why? It's Chilul Shabbat, baking on Shabbat, you're not allowed. Nobody is allowed to take dough and put it in the oven on Shabbat, you know it. When is the sin gonna start? When the top of the cake start to become harder. If it's still a dough, then it wasn't baked yet, even a little bit. Once the first layer, the top layer on the cake, will be baked, that's it. This person in Shamayim, Hashem writes in his file, Mechalel Shabbat. Violating the rules of Shabbat. If I'm there, and I can take it out, he left the room, he put the cake and he left. Once he left, it's in my hand to save his life now. If I take the cake out, he never got to baking. Even though he had bad intention, it never went through. He cannot get the punishment that the Torah says. There's only one problem. I cannot reach with my hands to grab the cake out. With my hands I'm allowed to take it out on Shabbat to save him. Problem is, he's all the way inside the oven and they use a special baker's stick. It's called Mardeh. And to touch that, it's a sin from Rabbanan. Not from the Torah. According to the Torah, you can use that tool. But Rabbanan made a decree that nobody will use professional tools because it would lead them to make a sin from the Torah. So they put a fence around the mitzvot. They say, no, it's muktzeh, you cannot touch it. The question the Gemara asks, can a Jew make a sin from Rabbanan, that rabbis made it, to save the life of his friend from making a sin from the Torah, that he deserves stoning and execution and karet? The answer of the Gemara, you'll be surprised, absolutely not. En omrim lo le'adam chete, kedei la'atzil et chavercha. You don't say a Jew make a sin in order to save your friend from a bigger sin. Remember this rule. Your life always comes first. Don't volunteer to help the other. You have to always first think about yourself. If you're alone in the desert, the Gemara says you have a little bit water for you and your brother, for you and your father, for you and your best friends. And there's only enough water to save your life. If you and him drink together, you both die until you reach the city. If one of you will drink, he will get saved and the other will die. Now you may think, how can I let him die and save myself? I might as well die with him. It's committing suicide. It's a sin. Not allowed to do it. So then you say, you know what? I'll be righteous. I'll sacrifice my life for my father, for my son, for my brother, for my best friend. Not allowed. You have to drink and save your life. But it's interesting. When it comes to money, everyone is very tight and stingy until they give a dollar. There's always exception to the rule. But that's what I've seen in the last 12 years. When it comes to mitzvot, everyone is so generous. Okay, you can do it. No problem. I'm ochel. No problem. You do it. Okay, you there. No problem, Rabbi. You can get it. You can do it. Why? How can it be? That's only one reason. You don't have belief in Hashem. No belief in the Torah. No belief in the Torah. You know, the Gemara says, a person in the old days, you know what they used to do? You're about to do mitzvah, and now the Jew that passed by jumped before you, pushed you, and he did the mitzvah. People were suing one another for stealing mitzvot. It's not fair. For instance, there was a poor person who is about to cross the street. It's mitzvah to help him cross the street. It's milut chasadim, it's mitzvah from the Torah. You did it, it's like pulling tefillin, the same thing, easy. You walk him, here, sir, let me help you cross the street. You're about to help him, somebody heard that, he ran, he pushed you and he grabbed his hand and he made him cross the street. Huh? Today, if it happens, you say, hey, what's wrong with you? Okay, no problem, take it. Why take it? In the old days, they used to sue one another. The Gemara says has to pay him 200 zuz. You know how much is 200 zuz? Thousands of dollars, salaries, for stealing one mitzvah from him, for stealing a bracha, for jumping on a cup of wine and making the bracha before you. People don't know. The reward for the mitzvot is so huge. When a person dies, how much the soul is going to benefit from the mitzvot, that if a person would know from one little mitzvah what a huge reward is going to get, believe me, it will push a person from a cliff not to let him steal a small mitzvah from him. Today, people are cold, comfortable. You do it, I do it. What's the big deal, Rabbi? No problem, let him. Why? When you see money, you're not so generous. Why? If someone comes with a $5,000 cash now and say, hey, somebody wants it? So when you say, let him take it. No, that's okay, let him. No, you take it. No, you take it. No, I don't see it. No, I need it more. You have, let me take it. You give all the reasons in the world why you deserve it before your friend. When it comes to the mitzvot, interesting. You should do it first. I give you the honor to do it. So, in the times, in a communist control, in the times that the communists were in control in Vilna, they used to have some kind of trick that they used to do. They used to go to houses of people and just possess the house from the owner of the house and give it to the officers as a gift. They steal your home, push you out of your home, and they steal your home. That's it. What are you going to do? If they knock on your door, you know you were chosen. That's it. You have no home. You have 48 hours to take your belongings and leave. Baruch Hashem, we don't have it today, these kind of things. But just imagine how it would be. So, one Jew came home and he saw a letter on the door. This is one of the apartments that were chosen to give it to the officers, the communist officers. And you have to give it out. So they came to the rabbi. Rabbi, what are we going to do? We're going to have to leave Vilna. What are we going to do? And pay attention to what he told him. He told him, in the Torah it says that Yaakov was running away from his brother Esav. Esav is coming with 400 men. 400 men to catch Yaakov. The Torah says that after Yaakov was fighting with the minister of Esav, with the Malach, the angel of Esav, the angel told him, your name will not be Yaakov, will be Israel. Lama, why? Kisarita im Elohim. You were able to survive in a fight with God. What's that? It was an angel. There was a material person, Yaakov, fighting against spiritual image, which is an angel of Esav. So that Rashi says, what do you mean you survive with the fight against the minister of Esav? Isn't it the fight is going on? Esav is right after that. Esav is after him. The Torah says that you already survived. You won against Esav. The next thing, we see that Esav is after him. Doesn't make sense. What's going on here? So now you're going to learn the concept how life is managed by Hashem. Pay attention, you may never heard that before. Everything that happened to you, every second of your life was decided up there. There was a decision made how it's going to happen, where it's going to happen, how you're going to get it, how you're going to take it, and how does it work? This is how it works. It's amazing. Every week, the battery died in the middle of the lecture. Much like this, every week. Hard to believe. MP3? Are you going to be able to give me like a copy? Because I want to, yeah.
What's the moment, you know?
I have so many. Now I see I ran out of battery. Okay. Whatever. Okay, now. So, the Torah told you, once the angel told him, you win, you won, it doesn't matter from this moment on what's going to happen later. Esav is coming, he's not coming, other people is coming. Once the decision was made by God that you won against your enemy, that's it. The rest is only what follows the decision. For instance, you went to court today and the judge decided you against Mr. X. You win the case, the rest, it's not, you're not a friend of the rest. You know the next step the marshal goes and pick up the stuff and he brings it to you and they evict him from the apartment, the rest is guaranteed. So between now until the actual court decision will be actually materialized, you sleep very well at night. Why? You have a court order. That's it. This is a court, official documents that this tenant has to get out of the apartment. Finished. Until the court case, things can be changed. You come, you prepare, you convince the judge. The judge likes you, the judge decides to your favor. After the decision, the rest it's only practice, only materializing the court decision. Whatever you see after, it's nothing. It's not important. What's really important is to get to the court and win the case, which means this is what the Torah says. Birtzot Hashem darkei ish, gam oivav yashlim imo. When Hashem is satisfied from the way of the Jew, even his enemies will be forced to make peace with him. The pshat of this pasuk, the simple way of understanding is, you have 3-4 enemies, they plan to hurt you, they plan to take actions against you, but God is satisfied from your way, one of them became sick, one of them went out of town, one of them just decided to give up, to drop charges. Who convinced all these people to do it? Hashem interfere. Why? You don't deserve to get any harm from these people. When God is satisfied, you have peace between you and God. Nobody can harm you. Everybody that harm you is not them. It's God harming you. Because you don't have peace with him. He's angry at you. That's why he sent you that goy and that neighbor and this and this divorce and this problem. You have to understand, your war in life is nothing man to man. It's all nonsense, illusion. You can never, that's why the Torah says, what's the point of taking revenge against anyone? What's the point? They're speaking against you, you are not 100%. If you were 100%, you wouldn't get to this situation that you get this. You wouldn't get it. You got it because of sin that you made 5 years ago. You got that because of a sin you did 2 months ago. You don't see the connection. But if you be 100% clean, nobody gets something he does not deserve. Therefore, before you thinking how I'm going to stop this person, how I'm going to fight against that guy, there's a question in the halacha. There's a Jew after you and he's working for the Israeli IRS. And he already he has a case against you. He has all the recordings. He has everything against you. Is about to put you for many years behind bars. And you have now an opportunity to trick him and to make him get hurt or something and he lose all his case. Are you allowed to go and do it or not? That's the question somebody asked Rabbi Zilberstein. He said, no. Your fight is not between you and him. Leave him alone. You have to make repentance and ask Hashem for whatever reason he sent you that officer after you, that you want to repent before it's too late. Once the decree was made, you have to work 100 times harder to erase it. Once the verdict was made, finished. Go and appeal now, it's much, much harder. A moment before, you sit 1 hour in your home with Tehillim, with tears. Please, Hashem, forgive me. I made a stupid mistake. I wish I wouldn't do it. I can't forgive myself. I deserve all the bad. But have mercy on me, give me one more chance. It's working. Better than lawyers, better than the best advisor. That's what people don't get. I know one wicked guy who lives in New York, in one of the boroughs. Really bad guy. He has good heart. Good heart almost every Jew has. That doesn't make him righteous, unfortunately. There's a lot of good Jews with good heart and friendly and nice, and they are 100% wicked from the Torah. They don't keep Shabbat, they don't put tefillin, they eat not kosher, they speak Lashon Hara sometimes, they're not so honest with money, they don't pay on time their bills. If you have the money in your pocket, and you owe the grocery money for no reason, you already have a sin from the Torah. Did you know that? What reason you have not to pay your bills on time? What reason? Who gave you permission to let another Jew sit 2-3 weeks until you pay him the money? But Rabbi, that's the way business is. He gave me 60 days credit. Believe me, if it was up to him, he wouldn't give you 60 seconds credit. He wants the money now. You just forced him. You told him that if he wants to do business with you, he has to give you 60 days credit. He doesn't want to do it. He wants his money right away. He worked for that. You take advantage on him. It's against the Torah. You are not alive. You don't have. It's a different story. You're also not allowed to take a loan from a person knowing there's a chance you cannot give it back. If you do it, you're wicked. You cannot take a loan from the Gmach. You want to open up a business. So all the nice people, they donate money to the Gmach, to the Gmilut Chassadim. There's a fund to help poor people to survive. Here is Mr. X. He wants to become rich. So he has a business to buy. $100,000. He comes to the Gmach. He lends from this 10, from that 20, from this 10. He has 100,000. He buys the business. If it's going to work, in 1 year he's going to pay back the Gmach. But what happens if it doesn't work? How exactly are you going to pay charity money back? Oh, what do you mean? Hashem will help. You know, one guy came to a shidduch. And the girl brought him to meet her husband. I mean her father. Introduce him to the father. So he comes to the father, and the father says, "So, young guy, Baruch Hashem, my daughter likes you, I see. Can you tell me a little bit about your family, about yourself?" So yes, he's telling him where he's from, where does he learn. So he told him, "Tell me, what are your plans for the next month after the wedding, for Parnasa? How are you going to make a living?" He said, "Hashem Yazo, God will help." He said, "Where are you going to live?" He said, "Hashem will help." "Did you find an apartment?" "We saw one apartment that we like." "You have the money to give down payments, you know, the security, this?" He said, "Hashem will help." "Do you have a car to go back and forth, to do shopping, you know, this?" He said, "Hashem will send us a car, Hashem will help." So the father said, "Psh, I didn't know my name is Hashem." The father realized, this guy is coming to suck my blood. Hashem will help. It's interesting. When the people, it's to their benefits to trust God, everyone is minimum Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. Hashem, what do you mean? What kind of faith you are? Why are you asking me this question, Rabbi? Give me the money and give me a chance. Hashem will help. But when Hashem didn't help, you have to give back the money. What do you want from me? Go to Hashem. So, the decision is what God decides. The secret behind this that it says, when Hashem is satisfied for you, even your enemies will make peace with you. You know who it is? It comes down to the bugs. Should know one thing. Chazal teaching us that when a person sees that bugs and flies comes into his table, he comes to eat, and bugs falling into the food, you know Hashem is not happy from you. That's why he sent you those, to disturb you inside the food. You come to eat, boom, little black dots all over the salads. It happens a lot. So what's the people say today? Rabbi, it's summer. What do you want? It's humid. They come out. You know, the town, they did not put the spray. They did not spray, you know, because it was a cloudy day yesterday. They couldn't spray. The swamps, there's tons of mosquitoes. Excuses you can find always. But believe me, the fly went to your plate and not to your friend next to you, there's a reason for it. The same table, 20 people sitting, only 7 of them got flies in. I remember once I went to a wedding, Everybody warned from that catering. Do not let them come. They're not so good. Do not. Yes, no, yes. So the people insisted. Why? Because they were the cheapest and they supposedly giving the best menu. And they didn't listen. And a lot, some people did not just come to this wedding. They did not trust that they will be able to eat there or whatever. And some just came without eating. Just come to the chuppah and finished and left after. And all the people who sat there, in the middle of eating the soup, I'm talking hundreds of people there, all of a sudden you see people running in the place, some people screaming, people are red, angry. You look at the plates, tens of little flies, you can hardly see them inside the soup. Not much like epidemic. Almost in all the plates, they run to the catering, the guy comes outside, Hashem punished everyone there. People ate flies. Each fly ate 6 sins from the Torah. 6 pieces of pork separate. Each fly. Multiply by 10, 20 in each plate. What they don't do in a year probably, they had that wedding. Why? Coincidence? Nothing is coincidence. Nothing is coincidence. Everything that happens to you, stop right there. Analyze it. Why? Why me and not my friend? We were both together. Why the goy spit in my face and not in his face? That means Hashem spit in my face. Why? I deserve it. That's for sure. Now let's think why I deserve it. If you think hard enough, you will find 3,000 reasons why you deserve this spit. If you're honest. If you're not honest, you're always going to find excuses. Yes?
So the punishment for an Avera is another Avera, right?
One sin leads to another sin. One mitzvah leads to another mitzvah. That's what the Torah says. Mitzvah goreret mitzvah, Avera goreret Avera. So then, this is what he answered him. He said, don't worry about the goyim take your house. We'll see what Hashem really decided. If Hashem decided we will have to leave our house, we care about the communists, not the communists. That's Hashem's decision. This communist is only the one who's going to materialize the decision. But he's nothing. He's just a soldier that came to take you out of your home like they just did to the Israeli settlers. All of a sudden the police come. The police take them out of the home. The police crying and the Jews crying. Both of them Jews. Both of them crying. The soldier didn't want to do it. You saw the pictures, know how they were crying, for those who saw a little bit about the news in Israel. But Hashem sent them to take you out of your home. Why? You know why? Why Hashem took about 11 cities out of there and gave it to the Arab terrorists? Why? Hashem liked the Arab terrorists better than us? For sure not. Hashem doesn't care about the Arabs. The Arabs are only here just to serve the purpose of treating and educating us. That's the whip. This is the whip. So what's the point? Why we have now to give the territories to the Arabs? No, who knows? You know why? There's one mitzvah in the Torah that the farmers have to give masrot, 10%, and to take out of your fruits and give out masrot. And then once every 7 years, there's 1 year you cannot do anything. You cannot process your land. It's called Shnat Shemitah, the land strike. You don't do anything all year. Don't put water, don't plow the ground, don't cut, nothing. For many years, those settlers, when they told them, hey, why don't you give masrot? Why do you work in the land even in the 7 years? Don't you know it's against the Torah? They say, what do you mean? This is not Israel here, Gaza, this. It's not the original Israel in the Torah. It's not Israel. Israel territory in the ancient time in the Torah, it's comes, that's the border. We are out of the border. It's interesting. If you're out of Israel, why don't you do Yom Tov 2 days? You know, the city of Eilat in Israel, in the south, it's not Israel. According to Rav Eliashiv, he just answered a question a few days ago, that they have to do two days Yom Tov. It's not Israel. It's the time of the Torah, it was out of Israel. So now it's a problem, because all the religious Jews that order rooms in hotels there had to cancel. Because what are they going to do? They're going to be in the hotel, they don't know tomorrow what to do. First day, it's Yom Tov. Comes the second day, they have to. What do they have to do? They have to light fires, they have to drive the car. But now they're having a problem, because if it's not Israel, you cannot drive the car. If an Israeli guy comes to New York, he comes to Muncie, he cannot light fires or electric, even though he's allowed. But in public, he cannot do anything. Only to himself in certain scenario. But if he came to a Jewish community, he cannot do it. So they cannot go over there. It's a problem. So for years they say, it's not Israel, it's not Israel. One day Hashem lost his patience and said, it's not Israel. Get out of there if it's not Israel. That's what happened. That's the truth. And he took them out with all the heart-ripping scenes that we saw over there. In the end, and this was righteous people. I'm not talking wicked people here. It's people that love Israel, people that keep Shabbat. Some of them more righteous than others, not all of them in the same level. But we are not. We cannot come and say all of them are wicked people here. One reason, it's enough. You lose your home. So here, once the Torah say, Yaakov won, the minister of Esav in Shamayim, the minister of Israel, won against the minister of Esav, every nation of the Goyim has a representative in the court of heaven. You should know it. That's what the Kabbalah says. Every country has a representative up there. And every time there's a decision to be made between a war that is about to happen, who is going to win, the Jews or the Egyptians, there's a big arguments over there. And the persecution over there say, hey, why you should win? Look what's going on in Israel. Look what's going on in Yerushalayim. Look what's going on in the clubs. Look what's going on in the Knesset. And then the other one say, look what's going on in your place. You are even worse. Look at the Goyim. Look. There's a big argument. In the end, whoever wins the case, that was decided. Once it was decided, whatever you see in a battle was already decided. What is it like? For those who know a little bit how it works in a stock market. In a stock market, you can go into the computer and you see how much the stock is right this second. The problem is, it's 20 minutes delay. What you see really was 20 minutes ago. Between now and the real time, it could be a huge difference. Some news came out, in 20 minutes it's going to be double. Whatever you see now, it's not really real. You are 20 minutes beyond the time. What is it like? That's exactly it. You only see in a war what really finished in Shamayim. That's what people don't. It's finished already. In Shamayim it was already decided how many casualties, how many these, how it's going to end, who's going to occupy who. It was already finished. Now you only see executing the court's decision. So what do you have to do? You have to make sure that the verdict will not be decided about. Once it's decided, it's going to be very hard. So he told him, if we have to leave our home or not, we hope not. But if it was decided, we should woo or should cry about the past. Why didn't we behave better that we don't have to get to that? And what happened? They were sitting in the house and their communist officers coming to check the apartments. They're looking inside the apartments, opening, checking. Beautiful apartment, wide, big, many rooms. And the officers, one after the other, does not like the place. I don't want this. I don't want this. Not one of them wants the place. And what happened? After months, when they decided to leave, without the officers, when they decided to leave, the next day, came one communist, and he liked the apartment, and the army paid them the money, and they got them out of the apartment. But that was after they decided to move to another apartment. What do you see here? Whatever you deserve, this is what you get. The Goyim really do not do anything to you unless if God approved it. The bus did not explode in Yerushalayim because the Arab wanted. There was one thing. It's not go by what they want. It go by what God wants. What God wants is the way you behave. Whatever you get, it's a mirror. You smile to the mirror smiles back to you. That's it. In that case, what's so complicated? All you have to do is one thing. You focus every hour of your life, how do I become better? Where is a yeshiva that I can go every night to learn 1 hour Torah minimum? Start with this. Where can I get some good books? Who is a rabbi that I can trust and call every day with my questions? How do I prepare? How do I get married? Which girl should I marry or not? What do I really have to focus on? How do I have to behave in my business? I have a lot of tests. People ask me if the bagels are fresh. Say no. The money does not come from the bagels. It doesn't come from the pizza. It doesn't come from the olives you sell.
Tires.
It doesn't come from the tires. It comes from Hashem. You understand? You have to just put a pipe. Where do you want the money to fall from? From this pipe? From that pipe? From this pipe? That's no problem. It's going to come. What difference does it make from here or here? So if you have a business, why do you set up a non-kosher pipe? The Chazon Ish says, we see reality that there are people who make their parnasa from robbing people, stealing. Without stealing, what money would they have, these people? Everything they own is not theirs. And the Chazon Ish says, that's true. To be a thief, it's a profession. It's a profession. Like to be a lawyer. Like to be a doctor. Like to be a shoemaker. They work and earn the money, and he earns the money by robbing cars, by breaking into houses. So the question is, tell me please. The question is like this. If that's a profession, what do you want from the thief? You know what? He's going to pay for the choice he made. God wanted to send him 100,000 a year. That was his decision. He had a kosher way to get it and a non-kosher way. Because he didn't have faith in God and he thought, I'm the one who's getting it and the more I steal, the more I have. God gave him the money in the way that he chose, which was non-kosher way. And later he will punish him for every penny he got through that way. If he would choose to make it by working as a driver, by working as a real estate agent, by investing and buying and selling stocks, doing kosher transactions, he will make the same amount of money, this time in a kosher way. That's the fool. He thinks, look, for all the robberies I did, look how much money I have. He would make the same amount of money in a kosher way. You don't understand. Hashem decided in Rosh Hashanah, when you came to the world already, He decided how much money you make in your life, from A to Z. It opens to some changes, but not that much. A little up, a little down. It was pre-decided. It's in the Gemara, it's not my opinion. The Gemara said, before you came here, they signed on you, rich or poor. So if they sign on you poor, as much as you steal, you stay poor. You lose. You lose for cancer, you lose for disease, you lose for divorce. Well, if they sign rich, you have to be rich, whether you're a thief or whether you're a kosher person. You have to be rich. You have to be. That's your correction. So why did you choose to be a thief? You could have become a loyal person and make the money in a kosher way without getting punished for it. What's going to be? Whatever you were supposed to get anyway, now you get in stealing, and now you have to pay for it. What a fool. And you know what the sad part is? That the thief has to pay double back. If he stole 1 million, he has to pay back 2 million. What happens if he dies without paying back? Just when he dies, even if he made so many mitzvot, first of all, every charity he gave, it's not his. He doesn't have any charity. A person that all his money is from stealing. All his money is from stealing. All his parnasa come, he's stealing credit card numbers, and he make 5,000 there, 2,000 there, he put stolen credit cards in his business, insurance fraud, all kinds of things like this. So that's all his money, 100% is not his money. Therefore, if he brings guests to his home, he has no mitzvah. If he gives money to the shul, he has no mitzvah, nothing. No mitzvah. He will not be shown in his record when he comes to Hashem. He said, Hashem, I give every month $10,000 to yeshiva. I never saw you giving anything. It's not yours. The money that went to yeshiva belongs to Ahmed, belongs to Christopher, belongs to Moshe, belongs to Yitzchak, belongs to Yosef. The 10,000 you gave, pay attention. This belongs to that goy. They gave. It's not your money. It's not your money. You buy etrog and lulav in Sukkot. The Torah says it has to be yours. You have no mitzvah. Stolen. Your children, guarantee, will go out of the way. Guarantee. That's why a lot of religious kids go out of the way. Why? Because they eat food, stolen food. No blessing in this food. Stolen food. Their father is a thief in a business. He steals from his partner, he steals from the government, he steals from this insurance. He brings the money home, the wife buys food. She's going to buy matzot in Leila Seder. They're going to eat this expensive matzot, and they have no mitzvah. Stolen. It's not theirs. They come to Shamayim empty. Empty. Even the books in his home it's stolen. Everything is stolen. You know how many Jews like this you have, unfortunately? Then people wonder why the shoes look like this. Why the yeshivot looks like this. What do you expect? Drugs laundering, money laundering, stealing from that, stealing from there, stealing from there. And the people have no way where to put the money, so they donate it. And you want money to the yeshiva, you don't care if it's clean or not. And all the Torah is produced with the blood of thousands of kids, drugs, money, prostitutions, avodah zarah, working in Shabbat. Now you wonder why there's no Torah anymore. Nobody knows. That's what's going on today, yes.
So all the brachot that the kids say on the stolen food is...
It's also, the kids do not get punished, because you're innocent. You have no way to look at something and know if it's stolen or not. By the way, you should also know, if you know a little bit dinema monot, when a thief stole something and he passed it to another person, the other person is yotzele dechova. Once it moves to another possession. But the Torah says, "Gonev mi ganav patur." When you steal from a thief, you are dismissed. Patur. Patur not from paying back. Patur from kefel. When you steal something, you gotta pay double back. You stole 100, if you get caught, you gotta pay 200. But if you stole it from someone who himself stole it, you stole 100 from the pocket of Shimon, who stole from Reuven. And it's really, you didn't steal from him because you stole something that belongs to him. First of all, if you want to return it, the obligation is to return it to the original owner, not to him. You have no obligation to him. You have an obligation to return it to the original owner.
So if you know who stole it, then you could steal it from that guy and give it back to the original
owner. Yes, it's mitzvah to do it. If I knew for sure that you have now in your pocket something you just stole from somebody there 5 minutes ago, I could have grabbed it out of your pocket and give it back to you. For sure. And if it's yours, if somebody stole money from you and is your neighbor, and one day a check came that was made to him, $500, and he came to your house, to your mailbox, and you open it by mistake and you see $500 to the neighbor, which you know he owe you $1,000. You can sign the back of the check and put it in your account. You don't need court, nothing. It's your money. Plus he still owe you $500. What do you think? The Torah is a school like in the United States to become a thief? Do not touch the tenant. We will arrest you. But he lives here a year and a half, and he doesn't pay rent. That's the law. You have to evict him by the law. But the law was designed to protect the crooks. What am I going to do? I'm going bankrupt. I have to pay the mortgage. Nobody cares about you. Let the crook live there as long as possible. United States of America. The number one school... how to become a professional crook and thief. This is the place. Everything from A to Z, it's false here. You go to medical school, bunch of liars, bunch of nonsense, bunch of assumptions, bunch of everything. You come to become a lawyer, right away they tell you, hey, if you're honest, you have nothing to be here. Just go somewhere else. Go play golf. This is a place for crooks. You're gonna be a shark here. You cannot be a lawyer. Come on, you be honest like this. It doesn't work. You know the joke. I told you that much. Heaven and hell, they had an argument. The wall between heaven and hell collapsed. And they've been arguing for a man who has to rebuild it. The righteous people from heaven say, you have to pay for it. The wicked people say, no, you have to pay. It's a mutual fence. And they say, both comes to us. We'll split it half and half. They went to God, and God says, the righteous people have to build the fence. So everyone asks, how can it be? The wicked, the hell, the people of hell won. We have to build the wall with our money. You know how? Because hell was full of good lawyers. They made the case very good. Oh, you understand? You know, I once told you another joke. You know, a few days before the election, there was one guy, you know, he came to Olam Haba, is now between heaven and hell, and Hashem says, okay, listen, I'm giving you a choice, go check those places and see which place you want to be there. He comes to hell, he sees parties, bars, yachts on the river, dancing, beautiful weather, wow, what's going on here? Music all over, good steaks on the table. Say, you know what? Nothing can be better than this. He comes to the other side, he sees the righteous people sitting, drinking, eating a meal, learning, enjoying, listening to some good music. He says, oh, it's nice here, I wouldn't mind, but can compare it to there. So I chose over there. No problem, let's take you there. They come to the door, there's a big black door opens, two huge hands come from the outside, from the inside, grab him by the hair, and drag him in. He comes inside, what does he see? Desert, thorns, 150 degrees, ugly people, faces, people are burned. So, well, what's going on? Where's the bars? Where are the steaks? Where is the river? He said, that was before the election. Now you vote already. That's reality. That's the way, by the way, the Yetzer Hara works. Maim gnuvim im taku. Did you ever hear that sentence? Stolen water will always be sweeter than kosher water. Always! Which means, you come to a place to make a scene. You have a piece of cake that it's yours, and a piece of cake that was stolen. It's not yours. When you eat the stolen one, you enjoy better. Both of them the same exact cake. Same kind of cake, same ingredients. This you like better. You go to make a scene with a woman. Rachmana Letzilan. And they tell you this one is married one and this one is single one. Here the sin is much worse than the other. Married woman, Eshet Ish, it's much worse than a single one. What's the Yetzer Hara push you to? To the married woman. How can it be? Why not the single one? To make half a sin. Not like this. Eshet Ish, there's no repentance for it. It's impossible almost to make repentance if a person was with a married woman. Once a Jew was with a married woman, his chances to have good life from this moment on are close to zero. Once, not more than once, one time, 5 minutes, 1 minute, it's enough. And I know some guys like this. None of them gets married. None of them has success in life. It's mamash destroyed your life. That's it. It ruins the blessing in everything a person touched from this moment on. Such a terrible sin. There's something that Hashem can never stand, mamash cannot stand, is this. It's worse even than Avodah Zarah, to bow down to an idol. And you know what's going on in the world today? I don't have to tell you. Just read in the newspapers what's going on here. First of all, some ladies do it as a hobby. But there are some ladies that do it because their husband supposedly forced them. He doesn't give them a get. He keeps them aguna for 2, 3, 4, 5 years. After 5 years, she's alone at home. She meets a guy. She goes out with him. And then they live like a husband and wife. They cannot get married because she's still registered in a rabbanut like she's the other person's wife. Well, what is she going to do? So she moves in with him. They live together. Every time they touch one another, it's a sin for him and him, which is terrible, terrible, terrible gehenom for this. Terrible. There's no words to describe how huge is that sin. And that's the reality we live in. I promise you that there's not one person here that doesn't know at least about one case like this, unfortunately. Yeah, that's reality. That's reality. I don't want to tell you what's going on in the... what from what I hear, sometimes it's hard for me to believe. I hope that these people lying to me, but since this story repeats in so many times by so many different people, sometimes I don't know, I don't have the strength to continue even. When I see how deep we got, how down. That the people, married people, mutually advertise to replace wife for wife. Advertise to do it with the permission of the husbands. Can you believe such a thing? Where did we get? Go tell it to the Arab, we'll see what's going to be your end. Go tell it in an Arab country that you want to do such a thing. The Gemara says, remember, a few things you learn here tonight, try never to forget, as another jewel. What is it? Israel, az shebaumot. A Jew is the strictest from in the entire nations. Az im ayin. Shebaumot, from the entire world. What does it mean? He is an extremist. A Jew is always an extremist. For good or for bad, that's his choice. Free choice. If he goes for the negative, it's going to be the head of the whole mafia. The head of the Russian mafia, in the end, you're going to find a Jew sit there, unfortunately. The head of all the drugs and smuggling, this Israeli guy. He came from Israel now to Miami for his trial. Millions of ecstasy pills, killing one person after the other. The head of all the credit card, the head of all the righteous people in the world, of course a Jew. The people that manage the world, the people that protect the world, the Jews. The same thing from the other side. You either hear or you hear, it's your choice. The potential that you have is great. So you can use your mind either to become Rabbi Ovadia Yosef or Chas V'Shalom to become a head of a prostitution organization or drug smuggling or weapon control. Who sell the Iranians all the weapons? Jews. Who sell the Arabs all the weapons to the Palestinians? Jews. What do you think? They use their head in a negative way. Negative way. That's because God gave each one of us a free choice, 100%. And in the end, you have to eat what you cook. If you didn't cook it good, it would be very not tasty. You know what's the difference is? That over there you will be forced to eat it. And I say, I can't. Mara say, we'll finish with this. We have 2 more minutes. Amar Rabbi Yochanan. Rabbi Yochanan says, one time I walked and I saw Eliyahu HaNavi coming to me. He had a vision of Eliyahu HaNavi. Like us. We have it every hour, no? Rabbi Yochanan saw Eliyahu HaNavi comes to him. Eliyahu HaNavi tells him, do you want me to take you into a tour in hell? To see what it looks like? He say, yes. I want to see what it looks like. And now he begins to write, testimony of a vision that he has, what's happening in hell. He says, he took me to the gate of hell and he started putting me in each section to see what's going on over there. And this is what I've seen. I saw people hung from their hands. They hung on an ankle, they hung with their hands. I saw people hung from their leg with their head down, upside down. I saw women that are hung from their chest. When they used to show it outside all the time when they walk in the street, measure for measure. You always go measure for measure. I saw people hung from their eyes while looking at all these naked women on the street every day and enjoy it. When we say it in Shema Israel, 3 times a day that we're not allowed to do it. 3 times a day he said that he's not allowed to do it. It's a very big sin to bring filthy things into the brain. And what does he do? He does it all day. And then, 7 years later, accumulate all the sins. That's the punishment. And then he says, he shows me a place when there are angels holding the hands of the wicked people, and one angel takes with a big spoon, sand, beach sand. You know, beach sand is glass. That's how they make the glasses. They burn the beach sand, and then it becomes... And the angel is forcing them to eat the sand. And their teeth are breaking. This is what it's wrote. It's in the Gemara. It's not a book that was written 15 years ago. This is a history of more than 2,000 years old, this, the Gemara, the Oral Torah, it's from the time Moshe Rabbeinu. Rabbi Yochanan, more than 2,000 years ago. And he says, he shows me people eating the sand, the angel is forcing them to eat, and their teeth are breaking full of blood, and they are trying to resist, because they don't want to eat. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, you wicked people, when you ate the stolen food, it was sweet in your mouth, right? Now you don't want to eat. What happened? That's it. Measure for measure. You there, you eat. Let's steal from here, let's cheat there, let's cheat in the application. Nothing is happening, Rabbi. Food stamps from here, from this, peos like this, sombrero, it comes like this in the prayers. All the food he eats is stolen. What's going to help? His custom will help him? Do you think that his punishment will be less than you because he has a yarmulke? Gotta be a fool to think that way. In the end, it doesn't pay to be wicked. I'm telling you, it doesn't pay. What you get compared to what you lose, it's very foolish. That's what they say in English, penny wise, dollar foolish. Here it's penny wise, billion dollar foolish. What do you gain for a little non-kosher food that you eat? You could have enjoyed from kosher food, the same pleasure. What do you gain by making a sin with a woman? You could have done it with a kosher woman, get married and do it. Why you need to live 7 years together until you get married in a sin? Why? Get married before. You don't want her, give her a get tomorrow, finish. You don't need a party. There's no mitzvah, you don't have an obligation that if you didn't make a party and dancing in a wedding, you're not married. The marriage is writing her the ketubah, putting the ring, going to, I don't know, any one of the Bukharian rabbis here and say, I have a girlfriend, I want to marry her. Why? I don't want to make a sin from tomorrow on. Without a party, without family, dancing, all this chuppah, this, none of it, sheva brachot. None of it is mandatory from the Torah. The Torah says, you come to a girlfriend of yours, you know you're making sins with her, you live like an animal, you cannot control your desires, you're in such low level that you cannot resist your desires. So what's the medicine for you? If you behave like animals, you have to be treated like animals. What's the solution? Since you can't control your desire, you might as well go around it. What's the solution? You come to the rabbi, what can I do? I cannot get married right now. And I have a girlfriend, and I make a sin. What do you do? I want you to marry me. Let me marry her. I marry her. A year later, we don't want to get married. What's the problem? We give a get, finish. At least, from this moment on, it won't be every second a karet. Every time you touch your girlfriend, if she's Jewish, it's karet. Because she has nida. She cannot go into the mikveh. It's worse than sleeping with your mother. That's what people don't understand. Why? They never opened the Torah. Not once in their life to read. In the same page that the Torah said, do not have relation with your mother or your sister, there is a stricter restriction. Do not touch any Jewish woman in a state of impurity. And every single Jewish woman is in a state of impurity from the day that she got her first period until she goes into the mikveh. As long as she did not go into the mikveh, all her life, she could be 60 years old, never got married, all her life she was in state of impurity, until she goes into the mikveh. Not only that, sometimes people make repentance age 50. Age 50, they found the truth, husband and wife. And they say, they say sometimes in the lecture, oh Rabbi, Baruch Hashem, I don't have this problem anymore. Look at me, I'm an old woman, 55 years old, 65 years old, whatever. That's it, I don't have that anymore. She doesn't know what she's talking about. She still needs to go one more time to the mikveh to get rid of the impurity, and that's it. She will never get it again for the rest of her life, because she doesn't get her period. If she doesn't, she's going to live another 10, 20 years with her husband until 80 years old. Every time it's a sin of karet. Worse than murder. Worse than chilul Shabbat. Worse than having relation with his mother or father or children. How many people are doing it? And then people say, where was God in the Holocaust? Where? when 80% of the Jews in Germany, in Poland, in Europe, started to become like goyim. Kippa went off, lawyers, doctors, check a little bit about the history. And then after 100 years, what patience, sometimes I wonder, what patience God has for us. I can't believe it. How? If one of us would have to be God for one day, I promise you, would not keep this world going one more second. One more second, you wouldn't be able to tolerate the wickedness of the people in this planet. You don't see the entire picture. If you only have a one picture of entire place in the entire world, in every room in the entire world, the idols, the sex crimes, the stealing, the cheating, the lashon hara, the gossip, the stingy people, whatever going on here, every second, as opposed to the mitzvot. How many people really do mitzvot? 100,000 people? And from 6.4 billion people? What's with the other 6.4 billion? Almost every second of their life is a sin. Whether it's a Jew or a Goy, it doesn't matter. A Goyim lives in a sin all the time. Every Christian, religious Christian, lives in a sin all his life. Why? It's against the Ten Commandments, Christianity. You should not have a son of God. That's clear in the Ten Commandments. You should not have any other God. So every Christian, right away, you have 2 million people. Let's say half of them are believing in J.C. Penney. So half of them, right away, live in a sin. Every Muslim that either murdered or pro-murdered or sponsors some kind of the terrorist organization or is happy when the Muslims fanatic put a bomb in a bus or killing innocent people, every one of them that has joy in his heart when it's happened, is a murderer 100%. Now count how many of those. All the Hindus and all the Buddhists that bow down to idols or believe in all these kinds of things, the cow, this, live in a sin every second of their life. Now all the non-religious goyim, which finally don't have a sin in their religion, because they don't believe in anything, now God has an expectation from them. First, they have to believe in the Creator. They see what's going on here. Second, they have to thank God. Third, they have to be honest, they cannot steal. The Torah say the punishment for the goyim for stealing is worse than the Jews. The Jew has to pay double and the goyim needs execution for stealing. Do you know how many goyim in the world you can point at them that say their hands are clean from stealing? Hardly one, maybe, in the entire country that you can say that his hand is 100% clean from stealing. Therefore, almost every goy is walking, but in Shamayim, in his file, God wrote, executed, finished. Why? He's a thief. Plus, I'm not talking about all the dirty sex crimes that they do, and all the other things that they do, and the way they dress, and the way they talk. This is all one on top of the other. Based on all that, now you understand what the Torah means, the merciful God. That's a lot of mercy. Believe me, if you give this book of orders to any one of your children and they behave against you the way we behave against God, I promise you, you would not be so patient with them. I promise you. Therefore, you have no complaint. What's the complaints? Complaints come from ignorance of not paying attention to the mission why you were created for. The one who puts you here expecting one thing from you. Soon we're going to get into Pesach. What are you going to do in Pesach? Sit in a bar and drink beer? For that you came to the world? It's against the book. You have to clean your house. You have to make sure there's no breadcrumbs. Nothing stays in the house. You have to take 8 days off. You have to go to shul every morning. And there's a special prayer, special Torah reading, special food, special mitzvot. Right when Pesach is finished, the times of the Omer start. The Jew is always occupied with mitzvot. Always. There's not one day that I can say, today we have vacation. Every step you make, it's either a mitzvah or sin. Depends where you're going. When you come out of your home, you have to know that. If in your mind you think, I'm going to learn Torah, every step you make to the elevator, down, to the car, driving, going here, coming out of the car, looking for parking, every second, it's considered a mitzvah already of learning Torah. Because you're on the way there already. If your mind is to go to a movie, to see all these dirty things that they show over there. From the minute you start walking, you consider a sinner. Before you even got there. You know that? Right away, what's in your mind, that's where you are. If you're in the middle of prayer, or you say Kriyat Shema, and you're thinking about the girlfriend you had 2 years ago, right now in Shamayim, Hashem writes that you went to visit your girlfriend, physically. Not only in the head. Where your mind is, that's where you are, not what you say. A lot of people can say something in a prayer and their mind is somewhere else completely. They think about the football, the baseball, about the neighbor, about this, about his brother, about what he hears in the background. It goes by where your mind is. And what's the proof for that? You can be in a place that you say something, but people see that you have goosebumps. Why? They ask you, what happened? You're so nervous. Your heartbeat went very high. Why your blood pressure went so high now if you're at work as usual? What's changed? You thought about the surgery of, God forbid, your son that is supposed to happen tomorrow morning. Just that thought came to you, your heartbeat went from 60 to 85. Your blood pressure went from 120 to 160, whatever. You are a different person. Some people may get a heart attack because of a thought that they had. Sitting in an office and punching a letter in a computer doesn't bring anyone a heart attack. You know what happened? They were now in a hospital. He was in a killing site. He was in jail now, and he was with a fight that he's going to have with his wife in 5 hours. And he was with a fight that he's going to be to have with his partner. And he knows that tomorrow he has a court case. Everyone is where his mind is. That's why in Judaism you have to keep your mind always clean. Whatever you think is a sin, consider a sin. One thought of a Jew, for good or bad, make huge impressions in the upper worlds. If you don't know it yet, it's a shame. Why? Because that's what the Torah says, yes.
Thoughts are more important than any physical action?
No. The physical action, that's what counts in the end. But there are a restriction, there's a sin to think dirty things, to think bad things. And that's why the Torah says, "Lo taturu achre levavchem v'achre nechem." The eye see, it goes into the heart getting warm, and the person moves into bad action. But the Torah says, "Irurei avera kashim me'avera." When a person made a sin with a woman, the sin was half an hour, and it's over. One sin, half an hour. If he thinks about her 10 years, never touched her. Just think about her for 10 years, it's worse than the actual sin, which is one-time event. This was 10 years of constant sins all the time in his mind. Where will he be punished more? I don't know. According to what it says in the Gemara, he will be punished more in his thoughts, because it's longer and it's more severe. But on the other hand, the Torah said that what counts is really action. If a person says, God, I love you, I believe in you, I believe in the Torah 100%, and he drives on Shabbat, he's a liar, he's a crook, what is he? He's a wicked person. What does it mean, God, I believe in you, I love you? The Torah says, you love me, you have to listen to me. You listen to me? No. So you're a liar. What's the point of lying? It's like all these phony people that light Shabbos candle. And a minute later, they light the TV and play with the remote. Who do you fool? Who do you fool? If it's the first time you're starting to become Shomer Shabbos, you don't know, you're hoping to become better in the next few weeks, it's a mitzvah. Even though you look like a fool right now, you're on the way to get out of this stupidity. You're out of it. You're on the way. But if you're doing it for months or for years, and you are normally living, working on Shabbat, making sin, open your business, smoke, do all these things, very nice of you. You bring a cup of wine, you drink beautiful wine, you make a bracha. Thank you very much. You light candles. What is the candle lighting? God, I'm accepting the holiness of Shabbat because this is the covenant that you made between you and us, the Jews, the chosen people. A minute later, he violates the rule of Shabbat every minute from now until tomorrow night. So tell me now, who is worse? A person that comes to court and tells the judge, Judge, I do not believe in the right of this court in anything. You don't have the right to judge me. I don't believe in your system. I think you're all crooks. And I don't believe in you, and leave me alone. And now he has to be sentenced for something he did. whatever it was, he did some violation, the court say you have to pay $10,000. That's the fine. The other one did the same sin, the same trick, stole the same amount of money or violate the rules in property, whatever. And he came to the judge and he said, "Judge, I always believed in the court. I think you are the greatest judges. Your system is perfectly fine and righteous. And I cannot find a better justice system. But I will do whatever I want, and I continue to do, and I do, and this and this." Who deserves it? Who is the judge going to be angry at it? You come to kiss me, to tell me how great I am, and you spit in my face? Who do you hate more? Someone that you knew from the beginning is your enemy and is about to hurt you, and in the end he did hurt you. Or someone who kissed you and hugged you and pretend that he's your best friend and stabbed you in the back. Who do you get angry more at? Who? No, the one who kissed you and hugged you. From him, you didn't expect. From him, you're much hurt, much more hurt. You know why? That's the same thing here. You come, you make a ceremony, you make an announcement, stand by the Shabbos candle, God, this, that. Some of the people, they're so ignorant that they light Shabbos candle at 9 o'clock at night. Come from work only at 8. So by the time they light, they make a scene of karet to light Shabbos candle, which is a mitzvah from Rabbanan. They light fire on Shabbat. That's reality. But those who know to do it before sunset, at least. So they light. So what do they say? They say, "Ladlik ner shel Shabbat." What's the purpose of Nerot Shabbat? To accept the Shabbat. To go into the holiness of Shabbat. What do they do a minute later? Turn the car and go to a movie. Or lights, turn the TV on. Now, this is being a hypocrite. And God cannot stand hypocrite. So what's the choice? I know what you're thinking now. So I might as well stop it. If I do it, why do I do it? I'm a fool. Let me stop. No, don't think that way. Think I might as well keep Shabbat. That's the right way to think. You know what? Until now I was a fool. I thought I'm doing something good. Now I realize how foolish is what I do. You know what? From now on, I'm going to do everything I can to change and keep the covenant between me and God. May we all have, Bezrat Hashem, a kosher Pesach. Every one of us that will have the house clean from Chametz 100%, his whole entire year would look better. You should know the night of Leila Seder, not to be a clown, no jokes, no none of these things. You have to focus on the Seder. The most important thing in the night is the story of the Exodus of Egypt. Wednesday night, you have an opportunity for a few hours to speak as much as you can. So if you don't have still books that speak about it, you go to the bookstores in English, in Russian, whatever you like, tell them to give you some ideas what to talk about, and they give you one or two books, and you sit with your family or your friends or your parents or your wife, whatever it is. The more you speak about the Exodus of Egypt, there's a bigger mitzvah. Plus, it's called Leila Seder, the night of the Seder, because the Seder in Hebrew means order. And means, it's according to Kabbalah, it makes order in your entire year. According to Judaism, now it's actually Rosh Hashanah. Nisan is the first month of the year. And once we start Pesach, it's going to reflect on the entire year until the next Nisan. If you want your year to be successful financially, in who you're going to meet to get married to, what kind of children you're going to receive, how well you're going to do in your business, and so forth and so on, this is the opportunity that will not return until next year. Those two nights, that's why I'm warning, please, no nonsense in the table, no jokes, try to keep it clean, focus on the actual eating of matzah, which is another mitzvah from the Torah. All the matzah that you eat, you have to lay, to lean on the left side, not on the right. You must lean on the left, and also the four cups of wine, you have to lean on the left side, on a table or on a pillow. And if you have any more questions about what to do and how to do, I'm available. You have 2 days. You can call me tomorrow and ask me all your questions. Okay? Remember, burning of chametz is Wednesday early in the morning. Burning the chametz. Checking for the chametz, it's Tuesday night, about 8 o'clock. You take a flashlight and a candle, you light the candle, you put 10 pieces of bread. Your wife, your roommate, whatever it is, in 10 different corners in the house, you hide them, very small pieces, mamash very small.
Only 10?
You put it in tin foil, and you hide it in 10 different corners of the house, under the beds, in the corners, behind the closet, whatever. And you write it down, whoever puts the bread, write it down where he puts them, not to forget. And then you make the bracha asher kiddushanu mitzvotav etzivanu al biru chametz. You're not allowed to talk between now until you finish the check. After 1 minute that you go with a candle, you turn the flashlight, make sure your battery is working, and you turn the flashlight on, you put off the fire, and you continue with the flashlight, and you check very well for at least 1 good hour or more in the entire closet. You'll be surprised how many things you can find, especially if you have babies in the house. Plus, if you have cars, you have to have in mind that when you're done with the house, you still cannot talk. You go down to the cars and check the car, check the trunk, check under the tire, because sometimes you do shopping and one little pack may fall inside holes in a trunk. Check it very well. And if you have two houses, you have to go check the other house also. And if your parents do not check, you make a mitzvah and go check their house also, if they're out of town or something like this. Yes?
Does a rental house count?
Rental house is your house 100%.
No, like if you own a 4-family, does that count?
Yes. Anything you own is yours. You have to go and check it.
Why do you live by yourself? Who's going to hide it?
If you do it, you hide it yourself. You can hide it during the day, that by the evening you may forget, but you write it down where you put it.
And they're saying that if you have your firstborn, you have to fast.
Oh, everyone who's a firstborn, everyone who's a firstborn has to fast on Wednesday from the sunrise until the night.
So it's women fast also?
No, men. But there's a way out of it. There's a way out of it. If you are firstborn in a family and you go to almost every yeshiva or any shul here in Queens, they're going to finish a gemara over there. It's called Siyum Masechet. If you participate in that 5 minutes that they read the last page of that gemara, they do lechaim, they take some wine and some cookies, you listen to the words that they say in the Gemara, you don't have to fast. It's considered like a holiday. Okay, women don't have to fast, so therefore women don't have to do Siyum Aseret. Thank you very much, and Chag Sameach.